Our next speaker is Dr. Vijay Suppiah, and Vijay trained as a pharmacist, so it's not altogether surprising that he entered the world of medicines, and particularly the world of pharmacogenomics and personalised medicines. His interest started with the condition of hepatitis C and sort of really wondering why it was that some people responded really well to the treatment for that, interferon, and other people didn't. And that work, I've just found out today, he probably knows for a little bit longer, has actually been selected as one of three national finalists for a significant prize called the Eureka Science Prize for the best translational medicine research. So he also has come to us very recently to take up an academic position, but where he's pursuing his research interests in pharmacogenomics. Thanks, Vijay.
Thank you for the opportunity to talk today, and thank you for the very kind introduction. I've entitled my talk "Island Hopping," and you very soon find out why I've chosen that title. As the early speaker, I'm not from Australia. I started off my journey in the little tiny island state of Singapore in Southeast Asia. And Pat mentioned, I trained as a pharmacist in National University of Singapore. Not by choice, but you know, because I couldn't get to medical school. I've got no regrets having been trained as a pharmacist, because I don't think I would have done as much as now if I had trained to be a doctor. I'd probably be, you know, hidden in some clinic in Singapore, you know, being very tired. Right, so yes, you know, you'll be very familiar with the Malayan if you've travelled to Singapore. The pharmacy degree, the pharmacy program in Singapore is very similar to the pharmacy program here. It's a four-year course. You do an honours project at the end of your, in your final year. So my honours project basically had nothing to do with pharmacy. It looked at the synthesis of small chain peptides and how they can be used to block an immune reaction. So that project basically sealed the deal for me. So I decided back then that yes, research is the way to go, regardless of what my career choice is going to be. So as I was preparing to graduate and enter the working world as a pharmacy intern, the head of school back then distributed this email saying, yes, there's an opportunity to do a PhD in genetics in Ireland. And she told us, look, what's the worst that could happen to you? They would say no. And you already have got a job, so you know it has got no impact on you whatsoever. So if you're interested, apply. So me being as crazy as I am, I applied, and I wasn't too sure who got the worst, who got the bigger surprise. The person on the other end reading my application from the other side of the world, or me when I got the letter of acceptance, because all you hear about Belfast and Northern Ireland the news are two things. One, bomb explosions, and two, the IRA. So off I packed my bag and went to Belfast, which is the capital of Northern Ireland. And I joined the genetics lab there, headed by Professor Koen Vandenbroek, and in the School of Pharmacy there. And basically, my project looked at the shared genetics of immune-related genes and how they impacted autoimmune diseases. So specifically, we looked at multiple sclerosis and the juvenile and adult onset of rheumatoid arthritis. Well, there was no surprise, really, because most of these genes had a role to play in autoimmune diseases as a whole. But some of the genes, you know, showed differences in the way they impacted these diseases. So 3 years there went really fast. You know, it was not all work, of course. You know, as you can see, being at the doorstep of Europe, you know, you take the opportunity to travel. So I think one of the big things, one of the big messages from my presentation is, yes, do work. If you get the opportunity to travel, please do so, because it not only challenges you. I think the big thing about traveling to a different country and working there is you find a lot of things about yourself, because you know you think, oh, I'm a small city state boy, you know, I can't live in the country whatsoever. But it's never the case. I think we are very adaptable, and it's amazing what you can find about yourself. So at the end of 3 years, I was ready to graduate again, and then the same question of what you're going to do after this. So there's two choices. One is to go back and finish my internship and practice as a pharmacist, or two is to stay in research. So I decided, right, since I've already traveled this far, I'm going to stay in research and see where that brings me. So back to the world map again. And this time I wasn't too bothered about where I'm going to go. I was more interested in what I'm going to do. So I decided, right, I've done my degree in pharmacy and I've got quite a solid training in genetics. So how about marrying them both and finding a project that that brings them together? So in pharmacogenomics, which basically means trying to find the genetic basis of either response to treatment or the non-response to treatment, or trying to find why certain people show either an allergic reaction or an adverse reaction to a particular treatment. So while I was keeping an eye out for that type of job, the answer lied across the equator on the other side of the world in Sydney. So I packed my bag once again and moved. This time I moved to Sydney and I joined the University of Sydney in one of the institutes. It's called Westmead Millennium Institute. It's in out west in the western suburbs of Sydney. And over there I joined the hepatology department, and they posed a question. Their question was very clear. Look, we have a group of hepatitis C patients. All of them are infected with a particular strain of virus. All of them undergo treatment, but only 50% of these patients actually respond to treatment. We don't know why the other 50% don't, and we suspect genetics could be the answer, but we're not sure. So my role there was to design and implement the experiment and find out if genetics actually played a role in treatment response in these individuals. So I took a traditional approach where it was a two-stage study. The first stage basically involved two groups of patients, the responders and non-responders to the same treatment, and trying to find genetic mutations in these individuals that are associated with response. So here we studied 300,000 mutations in genome-wide, trying to pick out these differences, and whatever hugely associated mutations were then carried over to the second stage, and these were then tested in another group of patients similarly similar in background, also have undergone treatment, and we know the tumor response. And the result of this was a huge success, I must say. We discovered two genetic mutations that play a huge role in determining who is going to respond to treatment and who is not going to respond to treatment. So currently this genetic test is being carried out worldwide just before placing the patient on treatment, so the doctor knows whether this patient is suitable to go on to treatment because it's got a high chance of response or not. If in the case that the patient turns out to be a non-responder, then you know other treatment options could be explored. So once again, 4.5 years there, and then I told myself, well, I should have a quick change, a quick look at my career before I hit the five-year mark. So at the end of 4.5 years, it was more or less again two choices: either to stay in research as a career scientist, or to move into either academia or the industry. I quickly ruled out industry for personal reasons. So this is when I heard about the position here at the UniSA to teach in the School of Pharmacy, and I thought, well, that'd be quite neat. If I started off in the School of Pharmacy and I end up in the School of Pharmacy. So there we go. So I've packed my bag from Sydney and moved to Adelaide. So this is the third move. So basically, I not only teach in the School of Pharmacy, I do a little bit of research as well, and I've got fantastic collaborators here who have got huge samples of patients who, you know, either have got epilepsy or arthritis, and so They do their research in these areas, not necessarily pharmacogenomics, and that's where I come. So I am keen in exploring why people respond and don't respond to treatment in epilepsy and arthritis. And the other arm, you know, working in Sydney with hepatitis C patients, you meet a lot of patients who have got problems with addiction. Addiction to various substances. So here there's a group that looks at addiction to opioids in treatment for chronic pain, and I'm interested to find out if genetics actually plays a role in predisposing these individuals who show signs of addiction to opioid therapy. So my take-home message is be as crazy as you possibly can, because at the end of the day, what you've got nothing to lose. And usually things work out for the best, and I think I'm a very good example. Thank you.